Hello and welcome to Health Live at Seniors Today. We are here once again with our monthly counseling forum. And as always, we have here with us Dr. Monica Das. Now, I know, don't need to do an introduction for her, but for those of you who have come in for the first time, Dr. Das is a chartered psychologist, a chartered scientist, and an associate fellow of the British Psychological Society. Professionally, she has counseled over 13,000 individuals in a span of over 21 years and has published several papers in both Indian and international journals. She firmly believes that any extracurricular activity can help tap into one's potential and bring out the best in an individual. Very well said, and welcome once again to the Counseling Forum and Health Live at Seniors Today, Dr. Das.
Thank you so much.
Over to you. Your subject for the day is stress. So, those of you who are here, who are attending, I must tell you that in case you have any questions, you can put them in the Q&A tab. You can post these questions anonymously in case you don't want your response to come in. If you're not able to do that, post off anonymously. If you can just tell us that you don't want your names there, we will not reveal your names in public. Over to you, Dr. Das.
Thank you. I'm going to share a screen now. Dear friends, can't see this. Okay, so I'm doing about a 20-25 minute presentation on understanding and managing stress, something which we're all very familiar with in our day-to-day lives. So what is stress? Stress is basically the body's reaction to any change that requires an adjustment or a response. And we experience stress from our environment, body, and thoughts. If you look at these two pictures, the multiple faces of stress, the one on the left, the main thing that comes out is depression. And then, of course, you've got many other words like anxiety, being miserable, breakdown, despair, sadness, hopeless, being frustrated, pessimism. And on the right, the main word that comes out is stress. And with that, we've got headache, sadness, pressure, work pressure, worry, depression, emotions at work, etc. So these are the many multiple faces of stress that we have to deal with on a daily basis. Right. So India is one of the most depressed countries in the world, according to WHO, followed by China and the USA. When I discovered this, I was quite taken aback, but this is the case. And WHO has estimated that 1 in 7 Indians suffered from poor mental stress. So the signs of stress which we encounter, the first one being psychological signs, such as difficulty in concentrating, worrying, anxiety, trouble in remembering as you grow older. Emotional signs such as anger, irritation, moodiness, frustration, losing control or crying. Now, irritation, losing control could happen as we grow older because of certain bodily functions, inability to move the way we used to move when we were younger. So there are a lot of causes for stress in this case. Physical signs such as high blood pressure, changes in weight not related to strict dieting, frequent colds or infections, low energy, and sleep disorders. And of course, behavioral signs such as poor self-care in terms of taking care of oneself, low self-image, not having time for the things you enjoy, or relying too much on drugs, alcohol, etc. to cope. So what happens when we get stressed? Basically, our cortisol levels are released. And this is often called the stress hormone. It basically increases your heart rate and blood pressure. So of course, glucose is released in the bloodstream, and this of course enhances your brain's use of glucose and increases the availability of substances that repair tissues. And all, it's also your natural flight or fight response, and this has kept us alive for years. So if you find yourself running from a particular situation which you know is dicey, it's because of the cortisol levels which are being introduced into your system. Why is stress management important? For several reasons. You are happier, you're healthier, you're much more productive, both mentally, physically, spiritually, in every way. You're more balanced in life. You're able to maintain good relationships. You're relaxed and you have fun. You're more resilient. So the more resilient you are, you're able to fight back. And the ability to meet challenges is something which is extremely important as we grow older. So some ways of, bringing down the stress levels would be one, to slow down, keeping calm, being positive, taking it easy, unplug, enjoy your life, have fun, breathe, relax, go out, smile a lot, and meditate. And one of the best ways of actually releasing stress is to give vent. So if you have to blow up occasionally, not all the time, but occasionally, do so. Because that releases all the stress that is within you, and you will be able to then sit down, take stock, and start again. Some more stress diffusers: therapy, spa, exercise, taking up a hobby, meditation, yoga, working with nature, time management, and music. This is a very important slide, and I've put this in because I want you to understand something. Stephen Covey, many years ago, wrote a book called The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Men, or people rather. And the one thing he talked about was the two areas of control. One area of control is the green area, which is the smaller circle. And those are things which are within our control. And then, of course, you've got the larger circle outside, with things which are beyond your control. So let's look at the larger circle. Things outside your control would be other people's actions, other people's words, other people's play, other people's behavior, other people's ideas, other people's feelings, and other people's mistakes. Now you really need to take stock of this. Actions, words, play, behavior, ideas, feelings, mistakes. So in other words, what is in your control? That is the only thing that you can control. You can't control anything beyond that. You can control your own words, your actions, your ideas, play, effort, mistakes, and your own behavior. The moment you start trying to control everything else outside this circle, it's beyond your control, and that's when you start suffering from stress. So basically, take stock of what's inside, and this is what you can control. Ignore the rest. Ways to manage chronic and severe stress: medication for sleeping, antacids, antidepressants, and anti-anxiety medicines. Psychotherapy. Now, there are various forms of psychotherapy these days. The first one being CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy. MBSR, which is mindfulness-based stress reduction, and rational emotive behavior therapy, also known as REBT for short. So CBT, cognitive behavior therapy, helps people identify and change negative thinking patterns. If you constantly, think of, for example, death or very negative emotions that come into mind, CBT would help you out. MBSR, which is mindfulness-based stress reduction, utilizes meditation and mindfulness to help you reduce your stress levels. And REBT is a type of therapy which was introduced by Albert Ellis in the 1950s. It is an approach that helps you identify irrational beliefs and negative thought problems or patterns that may lead to emotional or behavioral issues. So remember, CBT would be very apt for any negative thinking patterns, MBSR to reduce your stress, and REBT for example, if you have developed irrational beliefs and negative thought patterns. Now, stress is inevitable, and some of the signs of burnout that you need to look out for is your reaction to every crisis that occurs. So if every curveball in your life is a major crisis, that's a sign, it's a signal for you. Chronic low energy and exhaustion, another signal for you. Getting sick more frequently, it could be colds, coughs, running low temperatures, diarrhea, etc., etc. All this needs to be taken into account. Not recharging or not relaxing. Now, there are many people who just don't know how to relax. If you tell them that you need to nap for about 20 minutes, they're probably up in 10 minutes. And they're fidgeting. They're constantly moving around. So recharging and relaxing is very important to reduce your stress levels. Having a sense of inefficacy. The moment you start feeling useless, you know, there's nothing for me to do. What is life? Is it worth living? My children don't need me anymore, etc., etc. This is what you mean by having a sense of inefficacy. Feeling disengaged. Cynicism and sarcasm when it comes out in the way you speak, and not letting go of perfection. So these are all minor signs or major signs of burnout which we need to look out for. In terms of coping, regular exercise is one of the answers. It lowers your stress hormones such as cortisol in the long run, which I've spoken about. It releases endorphins, which helps your mood, and these are natural painkillers. Regular exercise helps you improve your quality of sleep. It increases your confidence, so the feel-good factor comes in, and it helps you strengthen your self-image. Now, it's very important to take care of yourself, practice mindfulness in your daily life, use guided imagery. I'm going to be doing an exercise on guided imagery at the end of this. Praying is a very important it's part and parcel of all our lives, and the way you pray, the depth, your involvement in prayer is important rather than the amount of time that you spend. Complementary and alternative medicine, you could look at acupuncture, aromatherapy, massage, yoga, and meditation for this. So in other words, to release and reduce your stress, you need to be selective. So focus on what matters, what is important, and let go of what doesn't. Let go of what you can't control. Let go of things that are a waste of time. Other things that you need to look out for where you would need to talk to your doctor is when you have prolonged periods of poor sleep, regular and severe headaches, unexplained weight loss or weight gain, feelings of isolation, withdrawal or worthlessness, which could lead to depression, constant anger or irritability. We're not talking about a one-off. Okay, this is just general irritation all the time. Loss of interest in activities. So basic daily activities, which you're used to doing in your normal routine, you start losing interest, there is a problem. So we're not talking about 1 or 2 days, over a period of time. Constant worrying or obsessive thinking. When you start thinking obsessively, a constant worry when you have plenty of time on your hands. That's why it's important to keep busy with something or the other. And as I mentioned before, the excessive use of alcohol or drugs or smoking and the inability to concentrate and focus on any one thing. So the 4 A's of stress management basically is avoid. avoid unnecessary stress, adapt to a situation, alter the situation, alter whatever is worrying you or bothering you. And the other one, the last one, accept the things you cannot change. So avoid, alter, adapt, and accept. That's the end of my presentation. Look at this lovely picture that I have. Happiness is handmade, and it is, it truly is. It's up to each one of us to make ourselves happy, to enjoy our lives, the quality of our lives, and the quality of living that we have. I'm going to do a guided imagery, and I'd like you to close your eyes, please. When things in your life seem almost too much to handle, when 24 hours in a day are not enough, remember the mayonnaise jar and the 2 cups of coffee. A professor stood before his philosophy class and had some items in front of him. When the class began, he wordlessly picked up a very large and empty mayonnaise jar and proceeded to fill it with golf balls. He then asked the students if the jar was full. They agreed that it was. The professor then picked up a box of pebbles and poured them into the jar. He shook the jar slightly. The pebbles rolled into the open areas between the golf balls. He then asked the students again if the jar was full. They agreed it was. The professor next picked up a box of sand and poured it into the jar. Of course, the sand filled up everything else. He asked once more if the jar was full. The students responded with a unanimous yes. The professor then produced 2 cups of coffee from under the table and poured the entire contents into the jar, effectively filling the space, the empty space between the sand. The students laughed. "Now," said the professor as the laughter subsided, "I want you to recognize that this jar represents your life. The golf balls are the important things, your family, your children, your health, your friends, and your favorite passions. And if everything else was lost and only they remained, your life would still be full. The pebbles are the other things that matter, like your job, your house, your car, etc. The sand is everything else, the small stuff. If you put the sand into the jar first," he continued, "there is no room for the pebbles or the golf balls. The same goes for life. If you spend all your time and energy on the small stuff, you will never have room for the things that are important for you. Pay attention to the things that are critical to your happiness. Spend time with your children. Spend time with your parents. Visit with elders. Take your spouse out for dinner. There will always be time to clean the house, fix things, or deal with things from your daily work, your daily chores. Take care of the golf balls first, the things that really matter. Set your priorities. The rest is just sand." One of the students raised her hand and inquired what the coffee represented. The professor smiled and said, "I'm glad you asked. The coffee just shows you that no matter how full or busy your life may be, there's always room for a cup of coffee with a friend." Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Are you there, Dr. Das? I think we have lost her.
Lost me. I'm back.
You're back. Great. You are back, but unfortunately, we do not have our Facebook session.
Can you see me? Hear me?
Yeah, so it's exceedingly upsetting and stressful. So guide me. How do I get this stress off? Nice.
That was a nice joke.
Not a joke at all, but I was exceedingly stressed about the fact. It's just that we goofed. I'm sorry. There's some mess up. So we have a question from Mr. Suresh Kamath, who says, which exercises are effective? I mean, yoga or cardio or weight training or is walking enough?
See, the older you get, you have to firstly understand what you can manage physically. So if you're between 60 and 70 and you're fit and you're, you know, going fine, and the doctor has given you permission, then going to the gym, doing some light gymming is actually not harmful at all. But in case you're one of these who, you know, who's got physical problems in terms of pain here and there, things which you can't manage, walking is very obviously a very good exercise, but nothing like doing yoga also. So if you can join a good yoga class wherever you stay, either with you know, with some others, or you have a private session with a one-to-one session with a person. There's nothing like this. But don't try doing this on your own unless you've been practicing yoga for many years. So gymming is something you can carry on with up to a point, but you have to figure out with your GP whether you're physically fit to do that.
Thank you. And we have a question from Kriti Dhruv, who says, what is the difference between neurotic and psychotic?
Neurotic basically is a person who, you know, you suffer from neurosis, for example, where you're worrying all the time about things. You're having these temper tantrums. Your nerves are on edge. You're unable to handle your daily life. A psychotic person basically can be pretty harmful in many ways. There's a question that's come up here. Psychotic people swing from one extreme to another, and they can be quite harmful in many ways. They need actual help in terms of medication. So that's where psychiatrists play a role with these sort of people, for sure, or even clinical psychologists. So neurotics are basically, you know, you're neurotic about everything. You're on edge about everything. The psychotic person goes way beyond that.
So we have a question which has just come on the chat window from Rajesh Verma, who asks, you know, what is mindfulness and guided imagery? Can you please elaborate?
Right. So guided imagery is something that I've just done just now, where you know, I've got you all to close your eyes and put you all into a situation where you had a jar and you were filling it up. But guided imagery also helps in terms of things that you want to achieve in your life, things that you maybe you desire, for example. So, for example, if you still not got a house of your own, you know, just material things, it's very important to visualize in a very positive and healthy manner the kind of home that you desire, the kind of place where you would like to live, the kind of family situation that you would like to be. This is what guided imagery is all about. And guided imagery does get fulfilled in the long run, provided you are not running after it. Okay. So I feel Dr. Monica to be like our loving family member. Thank you so much, ma'am. So it's very important to you know, ask for things which the universe can give you rather than ask for things which are impossible for the universe to give you. And that's where you need to be sensible in terms of what you're asking. Mindfulness is all about being in the here and now. So being in the here and now, meditation is one of these things which people talk about, but it's not easy to meditate. I do a lot of meditation myself. And you really, it's a technique, it's a scientific technique which you need to be taught by somebody rather than people just saying, go sit down and meditate. So mindfulness based learning is basically bringing people into the here and now and getting them to go forward with whatever is in their present, helping them to grasp, helping them to understand what they're surrounded with in terms of emotions, etc., and what they can take forward into their lives instead of constantly striving for things which you don't have. That's what mindfulness-based therapy would be about.
Thanks. We have a question from an anonymous attendee who says, we seniors are facing a new kind of stress. Everything has been made digital. Modi ji has made everything digital. User ID, passwords, etc., etc. Remember, to remember these, the way to use these, and at times the need to take help from neighbors, have to share user ID, password. All of this is causing stress, digital stress. So what should be done?
I don't know the answer to that. Very frankly, you really need to have a trusted member. It doesn't necessarily have to be a family member, but somebody you can trust who will not misuse your passwords. I've seen elderly people at the bank not being able to just, you know, put in their passwords sometimes at the ATM. So you really need to be very careful what you're doing in terms of sharing your passwords. A. B. This business of digitalization is driving most elderly people up the wall. Excuse the phrase. So basically, that's what's happening. If you can get hold of a youngster who can maybe help a whole lot of senior citizens, say, in your building, you know, somebody whom you can trust. So you get hold of somebody who's willing to take this up as a proper job rather than you just grabbing hold of your neighbor each time. And you'll have to keep changing your passwords. So somewhere you need to become tech savvy in terms of changing your passwords once you've shared it with somebody unknown. Am I making sense on this? So what I'm telling you to do is two things. One is get somebody in to help you out. Okay. The second thing is you have to change your passwords regularly because remember you are sharing your passwords with an unknown person. None of us share our passwords. We don't share our passwords even with family members, although you trust your family member. You know that they're not going to misuse anything. I don't ask my husband for his passwords, by the way, and I'm sure many of us don't do that. But the point is, there is still room for mistakes, and that's what you need to avoid. You don't want somebody accessing your bank account. You don't want somebody, taking... I read a story the other day of this elderly person who decided to buy an iPad. I think he discovered it was at half the rate than what it was being sold at. And this poor man ended up losing thousands of rupees because it was basically an online fraud. He was taken for a ride. He lost about 3 lakhs, not even thousands, for something which was probably about 50 or 60,000. So you really need to, rather than being penny wise, pound foolish, just be very careful who you're sharing your passwords with. Thank you.
Thanks. But, you know, it's easier said to be this whole thing of embracing digital, because it is indeed difficult for a host of people. And, technology is not necessarily very friendly. We've had problems we face problems with technology ourselves, and to expect people who have not lived their life in a digital way to do that. And as we have had questions in the past, which have spoken of kids not being very, cooperative or doing the right things for their parents, it is indeed difficult and stressful.
Well, one suggestion is that maybe seniors today could try and find a solution and, get somebody to help a whole lot of senior citizens out. But you need somebody trustworthy to do that. It's just a thought, somebody that they can trust.
No, I think it's a good thought. We should try and do that because it's clearly the need of the hour. And the very fact that you have questions coming in. You know, interestingly, the person who's posted this question has put it on Zoom, which is, you know, half the battle won, because if you can post this question on Zoom, that means you're not technologically challenged. But having said that, you know, one does understand that technology is a huge problem. We have a question.
Well, I'm always there to help out in case anybody needs help.
Of course, you are very much there. And they all know that. You know, Neela Mukherjee from Jaipur is a huge fan of yours and your voice and all of that. We have a question from Ram Malkani, who says, for exercise, one needs discipline and drive. How does one find that?
Oh, you can't. You either you're disciplined from childhood or you're not. It's as simple as that. At the age of 60, 65, to try and discipline yourself is impossible when you've not done it all these years. So the only thing I can suggest is at least if 3 times a week you can get down to forcing yourself to do some form of exercise to start with. You know, 3 times a week, some form of exercise, some form of movement, and then maybe you'll get inspired to increase the number of days. Disciplining yourself at this age when you've not been doing it for many years or most of your life is very difficult.
Mr. Malkani has another question. When on low energy, any natural stimulants would you recommend?
Glucose, electrol, but nothing more than that. Maybe, something like a bowl of fresh fruits. These are the things, but I can't think of anything which is you basically need a sugar intake, so you need a little bit of sugar which needs to go into your system, provided you're not diabetic. So certainly a bowl of fresh fruits, maybe ice cream. That would be something that would give you a good pick me up for the day.
We have Kirti Dhruv, who says, can hypnotism help decrease anxiety?
There are various ways of decreasing anxiety, and certainly hypnotherapy is one of them. There's past life regression therapy, which also helps decrease anxiety. But the root cause of anxiety needs to be tackled. So going to a hypnotherapist is not the answer. You really need to sit down face to face with a good counselor, try and figure out what is the root cause. You know, it'll take time. What is the root cause of what's causing this depression? Get down to bare facts. And then see whether you need, to go to a hypnotherapist. But don't just go. And that the other thing is, you have to find somebody who's good, even if you wanted to try this out. So again, it's like digitalization. These sort of things, you need to go to people who are tried and tested. Don't just go to anybody who says they're a hypnotherapist. Please be careful.
To our earlier question that was asked, we have Mr. Gurbir Straw, who suggests, who says, remember, discipline and regrets are both painful. Choice is ours.
Yes.
Very well said.
Very well said.
Straight speak. So we have a question from an anonymous attendee who says, kids are abroad. Who does one trust?
Is this a question for me?
This is a question for you, yeah.
Difficult one. A close friend, a youngster who's fond of you. The main thing I find when you grow older, this is what I'm discovering with more and more elderly people, so don't get me wrong on this, is that one becomes very suspicious of people's good intentions, people around you. And this is very important. It's an important factor to factorize in terms of learning to trust people who surround you. So you need just a few good friends, maybe a youngster who can help you out, maybe somebody's a family friend whose child is around who could help you out. And a lot of 13 and 14 year olds, by the way, are very happy to help out elderly people, I've discovered, because they're still not into their teens in a major way. They're still young. They're still warm and friendly. They're very happy to help out whenever they can if their parents allow them. So see if you can find somebody who can help out. And if your children are abroad, what about getting your grandchildren to work on things on Zoom? People can always talk you through, you know, explain what you should do step by step while you're on Zoom. So that's something else you can think about.
You know, and I must say here that, and that's a hint you gave earlier, and I think one must grab this opportunity and say it to the person who asked us this question, as well as to all others there. But in case you do have a problem where you can't trust anyone, you know, write to us at Seniors Today. Yeah? And if you can't write to us, call us up. Yeah? And our numbers are there on the website. Call us up and we will help you. Wherever you are in the world, wherever you are in the country, we'll be there. We'll try to help you in every possible way. I agree this is a problem. Technology is a bitch. You know, we have this problem. We had this problem just now. We are not able to go on Facebook because we have a technology issue. And we all face it. You know, we have been facing this problem with OTPs and getting, you know, our things right with our, you know, Seniors Have Talent contest. We are having problems with our vaccination. I know enough people who have this issue who have not been able to get the right center. So technology is a problem. In case you have a problem, any of you who are listening in just now, and you're not able to find the right person, you know, contact us. We are there every Saturday as part of Health Life. So even if you're not able to reach us, even if for some reason I, you know, none of us from Seniors Today have got back to us, please come here and we will help you with any problem you have. We may not be able to find the solution instantly, but we will get you. We'll get it. We'll get it. And we will, you know, with our connects across the country, we will try and get somebody to you whom you can possibly trust and whom we can vouch for. Or we can at least attempt to do that.
May I interrupt you, please, Mr. Maheshwari? The most important thing about this whole business of digitalization is, please don't get yourself into a mess where you are, you know, money is going out from your bank accounts in an unauthorized manner. So you have to be very clued in, very, very clued in. Don't trust, don't just give over passwords unnecessarily, and don't do anything online if you don't know how to do it. Please wait, ask for advice, contact somebody from Seniors Today, but don't do it on your own if you can't manage, you know, if you're not tech savvy. Very important.
Absolutely. You know, we've heard enough stories. You will read in the papers where people have been, you know, people have lost lakhs of rupees because they got an email address or they've got a call saying that please give us your bank account number, please give us this. And, you know, these messages come in. So, so please be exceedingly careful. Well, moving on. We have a question from Neela Mukherjee, your fan from Jaipur, who says,
thank you, ma'am.
Eye specialists suggested to wash eyes to avoid an eye strain due to online program after each hour. Is eye strain equal to stress?
Yes. And particularly more so if you get an eye tick, you know, when your eyes start ticking. So rinsing out your eyes is very important. And you do need to, you know, Ayurveda has a certain oil which you can sort of use in terms of cleansing your eyes. But you need somebody to teach you how to use that. But eye drops, certainly the Ayurvedic ones which you get at a medical store will do the trick. Please rinse your eyes out. And this business of too much of computer usage is very important for all of us to try and refrain from. So it's important, yes.
We've received two questions, one from an anonymous attendee and the other from somebody else who's talking about medicines or whatever. We do not want to get into medicine and drug names over here. So we are not going to get into addressing your questions. You need to look at consulting a doctor for help on medicines that you have raised. But we have a question from an anonymous attendee, another question, who says, how does one do away with a feeling of fear, particularly during nights, of ghosts seen in the movies and heard from people around?
Can you repeat the last bit? What was that about the movies?
Ghosts seen in movies, ghost scenes, and you know, what the person may have heard from people around about ghosts.
Okay. So just a couple of things. One is have an early dinner. And the second thing is stop watching too many movies, particularly at night. So maybe get down to reading, listen to music, chatting with family. But don't watch too many movies if that's going to be playing on your mind. You know, the dreams we have are the last sort of things we've been doing, listening to, or discussing before going to sleep. So please, you know, if you are in that frame of mind, just stop watching these sort of movies. And why do you have to watch movies with ghosts anyway? I don't.
Well, yes, that's a good idea not to watch these movies. I don't watch them either. We have a question from someone who says, my son and his wife are not getting along well and have arguments. Can you suggest a marriage counselor in Noida or Delhi?
I don't know of anybody offhand, but I can certainly do some homework and get back to Mr. Maheshwari if you're really seriously interested in this.
You know, the person who's asked this question, if you send us a mail at editor@seniorstoday.in, we will have your email address and we will send you some the name of marriage counselors and lawyers in Delhi or Noida. We have a question from an anonymous attendee again, who says, I get frightening dreams every night. What does it mean?
That all depends. A lot of this depends on what you're eating. So if you're going to be having very rich food or heavy food or a lot of cheese, for example, you know, any milk products at night is a big no-no, particularly because of when you have these sort of dreams. So you really need to, A, have dinner by 7:30 in the evening, and a lightish dinner followed by maybe a warm drink of some kind. But try and reduce the rich food, you know, the masala intake at night and the cheese intake. That's one thing. The second thing in terms of dreaming, it could be a lot of time what's being played out in terms of what is happening in your life. So, you know, there are various instances which could be worrying you, and they come out in the form of dreams or nightmares, which is in a way your body or your mind or your whatever is trying to cope with things. Sometimes the messages which we don't know about and we don't even realize. But a lot of the time, most nightmarish dreams have a meaning which we have no idea about unless you're with an expert who can explain dreams. But the main thing is cut down on rich food at night. This is very important. And please walk earlier in the evening. Don't go for these very strenuous walks at night, you know, after dinner.
We have a question from someone who says, I understand there are some happiness hormones in the body, like endorphin, dopamine, etc. Please suggest how to induce in the body.
Okay, so let's look at things that make us happy. Can we have some answers from the participants here? Just type in some answers in the chat. What makes you happy?
Flowers, someone says. Very nice.
Flowers? Okay, lovely. Some more answers, please. What makes you happy? Come
jokes.
On, participants.
Jokes.
Jokes.
Says
yes.
Good job.
laughter of children, compliments, good health, good mood of wife. Why only good mood of wife? Okay.
Listening to music.
Music. What other things make you happy? Spending time with self.
Interesting. Comedy movies.
Okay.
Not horror movies.
What else?
Reading books.
These are the things you should be doing to keep you happy.
Absolutely. The answers are from themselves, and children's love eating good food. I agree. So, yeah, so we've got all the answers. Being with friends, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a question from Ram Malkani, who, the last question for the day, any group therapy available for elders where we can exchange experiences? I'm going to take this question, if you don't mind. So, you know, this is supposed to be, in a sense, a group therapy for everyone. All of you here have responded to the questions so very well. So, you know, like for instance, this question about what gives people happiness. So, you know, we are happy and you also know that this happens on the first Saturday of every month. So join us here, share your experiences, you know, ask questions if you want any clarifications. And as you know, what Dr. Das is suggesting over here is not definitive solutions for everything. For some, there are no solutions available. Like for instance, this entire thing of technology or whatever else. We are all suggesting things that you can possibly do. Over to you, Dr. Das. How do you, is there anything else?
No, I totally agree with you. So the main thing is, this is actually a form of group therapy that is happening without any of us realizing. It's therapy for Mr. Maheshwari and it's therapy for me, by the way. Just the fact that you're able to think of answers, you're able to look at suggestions, you're able to discuss, you're able to just be together. That's a form of positive therapy. And let me tell you, when you leave this session, 99% of the time you go away feeling light, you go away feeling happy. And that's what group therapy is all about, because you've been given some information which maybe will work out for you if you try it out.
But you haven't been able to solve my stress about this session not going
You've
on.
You've not asked me.
but anyway, those of you, you know, those of you who are over here, thanks for joining in. Thanks once again, Dr. Monica Das, for being here.
Pleasure.
Joining us every month on a Saturday evening, which is an important day of the week for all of us. And you spend quality time with us on, you know, the early part of the evening. So thank you for being there, and thank you to everyone else. You know, there were hardly any questions which came in, but everybody participated, and that's what gives this entire effort, you know, makes this entire effort very successful. And we're delighted with the response, and of course we're not delighted with the fact that people have issues in life, but obviously if we are able to help in any possible way, the job is done for us at Seniors Today. Thank you once again, Dr. Das, for being here, and to all our you know, viewers who have joined us over here. We will be back once again next Saturday at 5 p.m. and with Dr. Das once again next month, which is 3rd of April. April 3rd, that's the Easter weekend, so the day after Good Friday and the day before Easter Sunday. So we would meet you there, and thank you once again.
Thank you so much.
Hello and welcome to Health Live at Seniors Today. We are here once again with our monthly counseling forum. And as always, we have here with us Dr. Monica Das. Now, I know, don't need to do an introduction for her, but for those of you who have come in for the first time, Dr. Das is a chartered psychologist, a chartered scientist, and an associate fellow of the British Psychological Society. Professionally, she has counseled over 13,000 individuals in a span of over 21 years, and has published several papers in both Indian and international journals. She firmly believes that any extracurricular activity can help tap into one's potential and bring out the best in an individual. Very well said, and welcome once again to the Counseling Forum and Health Live at Senior Sudhir Dr. Das.